here is the resting cardiac myocyte. It is very important to note that at rest, the interior of the cell is negative when compared to the exterior of the cell. It is minus 90 millivolt. And this charge difference across the membrane at rest is called the resting membrane potential. If I take a micro syringe and inject some potassium into the cell, this will cause a rapid change in a membrane potential across the cell. Potassium is a cation, positively charged ion. When positively charged ions enter the cell, the interior of the cell becomes more positive. This little change in the membrane potential makes the cell permeable for some cations, which flux to the cell, making the membrane potential rapidly more electropositive. In a nutshell, this rapid change in a membrane potential, which is propagated along the cell, is called the action potential. So let's talk about it in a little bit more detail. It is very important to note that every muscle in a body first must be stimulated by an electrical impulse before the muscle can contract. And cardiac muscle is not an exception. The cardiac muscle itself must also, in order to contract and pump blood through the vessels, should receive electrical impulses first. This electrical impulse or action potential is generated in a SA node continuously because it is a natural pacemaker, as you know. And only then will this action potential spread to the atria and ventricles, and they contract and pump blood to the vessels. It is very important to note that the cardiac action potential differs significantly for each portion of the heart. These are five action potentials of the myocardium: action potentials of the SA node, atrial muscle, AV node, Purkinje cell, contracting ventricular muscle. But in this video, we'll talk about the action potentials in non-nodal cells, which involve atrial myocytes, ventricular myocytes, and Purkinje cells. First, we'll talk about ventricular action potentials. Whenever we talk about the action potential, first we should know the main ions and channels through which these ions move and generate action potential. The main ions participating in generation of the action potential in a ventricular muscle are sodium, potassium, and calcium. Here are the five different channels in a ventricular myocytes: voltage-gated sodium channel, voltage-gated calcium channel, inward-rectifying potassium channel, IK1 channel, transient outward potassium channel, IT0, delayed-rectifying potassium channel, IK channel. In order for us to better understand ventricular action potential, let me draw here two cells from the ventricle. The second cell I will draw smaller than first because we will deal with the first cell mainly. It is very important to note that the atrial and ventricular muscle cells have stable resting membrane potential of about minus 90 millivolt. It is very important to note that in an interstitial fluid we have high amount of sodium when compared to intracellular fluid, but potassium is opposite. As for calcium, its concentration is higher outside the cell than inside. Under resting conditions, potassium conductance in a cardiac myocyte is high. This is because of two types of potassium channels which are open: ungated potassium channels and the inward rectifying potassium channel, IK1 channel. Both channels allow potassium to move freely across the cell membrane. Because of this, the resting membrane potential is close to potassium equilibrium potential, which is approximately minus 95 millivolts. The threshold potential is around minus 70 millivolts. So if I take a micro syringe and stimulate the cell by injecting a certain amount of potassium, the membrane potential becomes more positive because potassium is a positively charged ion. If the amount of potassium I have injected is enough to take the membrane potential up to the threshold potential, then suddenly and quickly fast voltage-gated sodium channels open up and sodium massively starts rushing to the cell down its electrochemical gradient. Sodium influx makes the membrane potential positive. This is called depolarization of the membrane. When the membrane is depolarized, voltage-gated sodium channels close and sodium stops rushing to the cell. When voltage-gated sodium channels close in response of depolarization, another channel, which is called transient outward potassium channels, IT0 channels, open up and a small amount of potassium leaves the cell. Transient potassium efflux makes the membrane potential a little dip down and then this channel quickly closes. In addition, we have opened ungated potassium channels which also allow potassium to leave the cell. It is very important to note that inward rectifying potassium channels, IK1 channels, which were open under resting conditions, close near the end of depolarization at this point. But in response of depolarization, another channel which is called delayed rectifying potassium channels, IK channels, open and potassium leaves the cell. It is extremely important to know that when the membrane potential becomes a little dip down, the voltage-gated calcium channels open up, especially L-type channel, and conductance for calcium increases, allowing calcium to leak into the cell because the concentration of calcium is higher outside the cell than inside. Very important and big point here. When delayed rectifying potassium channels, IK channels, and voltage-gated calcium channels are open, we get high conductance for potassium as well as for calcium at one and the same time. Potassium efflux and calcium influx balance each other, so the membrane potential will be stable and we get the plateau phase. Then the voltage-gated calcium channels close and calcium influx stops. However, remember, in the end of the plateau phase, delayed rectifying potassium channels open more rapidly and we get the massive potassium efflux. Massive efflux of the cation returns the membrane potential to its resting state. This is called repolarization of the membrane. When repolarization ends, delayed rectifying channels close and potassium stops leaving the cell through this channel. Another important point here is that in the end of repolarization, inward rectifying potassium channels, IK1 channels, reopen and further facilitate potassium's movement. It is very important to note that in the end of this cell, when sodium rushes into the cell and depolarizes the membrane, some cations pass through the gap junctions and enter the adjacent cell. When positive ions enter the cell, it takes the membrane potential of the cell up to threshold. When the threshold is reached, voltage-gated sodium channels open up and sodium fluxes into the cell, further causing depolarization, and so on and so forth. It is important to note, in order to re-establish the resting membrane potential, the cell should pump sodium out and return potassium back into the cell. For these purposes, There are a lot of sodium potassium ATPase on the surface of the membrane. The sodium potassium ATPase pumps 3 sodium out and 2 potassium into the cell.